Well, thanks, Phil, for that important update. It's so important, this registry, as we chart a course towards treatments and cures. I'm Brian Harmon, President and CEO of the United Mitochondrial Disease Foundation. And boy, today I'm really proud of the amazing network of experts that have gathered today. And what an impressive slate of presentations. Phil, I think we owe a big virtual applause for all of our presenters and panelists. I won't make my mic go off too loud here, but a virtual applause for all of you. What a fantastic day. I'll tell you, the biggest takeaway for me today was just the sheer amount of activity happening. And, you know, something else I really appreciated, having a chance to listen in on that patient family perspective,
right?
That patient family panel. You know, ultimately, that's what this is all about. It's why we gather. It's why we do this work. It's why we consistently go fast. It's a great reminder of why we do what we do. It's clear so much good work is going on. I'm curious from you, Phil, just some of your key takeaways from today.
Absolutely. And you know, before I share the key takeaways from today's meeting, I thought I'd share this. It is the year 2020 after all, Brian.
Nice. And, you know, oh, look at that.
We have to have our mask on. And I know we're several hundred miles remote from each other, but still important that we practice social distancing
Very
and wear
good.
A mask. And if anybody is interested in this mitochondria powerhouse of the cell mask, we can always post the link inside the chat there too.
But nice plug.
Thought I'd share that. I like that. So yeah, today's meeting, there were a number of takeaways, and much like you, I've tried to kind of, you know, coalesce that down to two or three thoughts for it. My first is very similar to yours, and that's, we have to listen to the patients, right? That you know, you hear that from the regulators, you hear that from industry, and hopefully the patient community knows you hear that from UMDF, that we're listening, and that's the way we understand mitochondrial disease in a way that treatments and cures can be developed that are meaningful to them. So that was the first big takeaway for me. You know, the second is, if you look at all the clinical trial activity that's taken place over the last decade, none of it has delivered what we ultimately want, which are actual therapies, approved drugs for mitochondrial disease, but we've learned a lot from it. And we had so many join us today that were willing to share their learnings and help others now going forward to do it better. So that's a big takeaway, that we have a community that's willing to work together, figure out what it is that we can do better and begin to act on it. And, you know, lastly, you know, that you heard it in my registry update, it's so important that we identify and characterize as many mitochondrial disease patients as possible. And there's lots of ways to do that. It could be through a patient populated registry. It could be through a clinical research network like NAMDAC, through surveys, through meetings. You know, I think for UMDF and its mission, that's really critical, right, going forward, that we build out the natural history associated with mitochondrial disease and do it in a way that's going to facilitate clinical trials going forward. There's so much more that I could talk about, but I'm just thrilled that the best and the brightest of the mitochondrial disease community spent time with us today to share their thoughts and insights.
Well, speaking of the best and the brightest, Phil, we're about to announce the award winners for the UMDF Prize Awards this year, and we're really excited once again to provide two $100,000 prizes along with the $50,000 Accelerators Prize. But I thought it might be good for the audience, Phil, first to hear a little bit how the grant process works at UMDF.
Sure. Yeah. So our annual grant cycle typically opens in January of any given year. And that begins with us posting a request for proposals. And that's the opportunity for us to detail, this is the type of research we're looking for, whether it be basic, translational, or clinical. And of course, that's also our opportunity to say, we're looking to fund across all career stages, from postdoctoral fellows to early stage investigators to experienced investigators. Every year, it changes a little bit, the mix, the focus, but the RFP is what drives then the submissions. And those roll in over a February kind of timeframe, right? January into February, so that by March, we can begin the peer review process. And so in this year, for this grant cycle, we received 60 applications from, how many did I count? 11 different countries. So very international in the mix. From that 60, we have the somewhat daunting task of now triaging down those that are most relevant to UMDF mission, were most responsive to the RFP, which frankly excite us the most, right, about the potential and the impact. And that is a very subjective process. And I know we disappoint a lot of people sometimes that we can't move them all forward. We just don't have the bandwidth to, you know, to review all of them. So from the 60, we triage down to 24 that undergo significant peer review. And as you know, Brian, peer review is the hallmark of the UMDF grant process. And that's where we get several sets of eyes looking at each application to judge the scientific merit of it. So from there, that takes place in April into May, and now here we are in June. We now have opinions from our scientific and medical advisory board and other outside experts that help, you know, people like you and I, the leadership team, the board of trustees of UMDF, to make decisions about who we want to provide our awards to. So I think with that—
And here we are, right?
Here we are.
I want to share too another tenet of this program, of this process, is the support from our donors. And I want to extend a thank you again to our corporate partners who have made today possible, our donors from across the globe who have made mitochondrial disease patients a priority. And when we have that kind of support, we are able to continue to fund really important projects and move fast towards treatments and cures. And at a time right now when there are tough decisions to be made, we're grateful that the community has continued to prioritize our organization. So without further ado, I do want to share this year's winners. So the 2020 Early Stage Investigator Prize, this is a $100,000 prize, goes to Breanne Brown from Vanderbilt University. This is for her project, Mechanisms of Protein Assembly, Underlining Mitochondrial DNA Maintenance, but Altered in Early Onset Neurodegenerative Disorders.
Red, it's still showing, it's still screaming.
The 2020 Experience Investigator Prize, another $100,000 prize, goes to Hajime Saikai from Napagen. It's the implementation of CRISPR gene editing technology, edit plasmids, toward the curing of mitochondrial disease caused by mutations in mitochondrial DNA. And of course, as you heard today, and I hope you will tune in for tomorrow, our $50,000 Accelerators Prize will be determined tomorrow. We have our live pitch, the big pitch. Come back to the Power Surge at lunchtime to watch that. We've got two fantastic projects that are vying for that $50,000 prize. Encourage you to, again, go check out umdf.org/accelerators to learn more about this program. It's a very unique program that bridges engaged philanthropy and fast science, giving our donors an opportunity to choose one of those vetted projects. And that's going to happen tomorrow. So please tune in again tomorrow. Speaking of going fast, it's our mantra at UMDF. This is what we aim to do. And the presentations today are, they're proof positive that we are all bringing that attitude to bear. And we're really grateful for that. We are grateful that you're going fast with us. And on behalf of the thousands of patients we serve, we thank you for joining us today. Thank you, everyone, and have a great day.
Thanks, everybody.